Hi, everybody. How's it going?
Hello, Jacob.
Hi, Jacob.
Hi, Jacob.
My name is Jacob Smith. For those that don't know me, for those tuning in on the World Wide Web. I'll introduce myself. So my name is Jacob. I am the community director for a project called Collider. We are effectively building a community of technical professionals and business people, bringing everyone together to break down barriers and talk about technology innovation, driving innovation. So today we are very excited to be joined by Matt Stewart from Grafana Labs. We're gonna be talking about implementing observability with open source, a topic that I do not know a lot about, so that's why we bring in the experts to tell us more. And I'm actually gonna go ahead and just hand it off to Matt to kick things off in the interest of time. And if you could give us a little bit more of an introduction so we know what we're talking about, and we'll take it from there.
No doubt.
All right. Thank you, and thank you for having us and hosting us here. For those of you online that aren't here in person, Altmetric has an awesome space here in downtown Detroit. So when they're hosting events, definitely come on by. We're going to be talking a little bit about observability today and open source. Again, my name is Matt Stewart. I'm a solutions engineer at Grafana Labs. We are the company behind Grafana, Loki, Tempo, Mimir, K6, and some other technologies. I'm actually Chicago-based. This is my first time in Detroit, so it's good to be here. As you can see, I did not update this slide properly, and I don't have 25 years of monitoring experience. That was from a previous colleague, but I've been with Grafana for about 3 months. Yeah, right. Yeah. I think I had my 3 months yesterday. I spent about 5 years at Elastic before this, doing very similar things, both in the observability and the security world. And I work with some of the larger companies here in Detroit, as well as some companies up in Chicago. And I like to golf when it's not snowing out in Chicago, as you know, here in Detroit, very similar. Basketball, guitar, you know, a little bit about me. But talking about observability, so we are one of, you know, a handful of vendors in the space that do observability, and we think we do it really well. We're a company of about 800 strong as of recent. About a year ago, there was, I think, like 300 of us. So we're growing very, very quickly, and in our eyes, we're building some really cool tech that is really being widely adopted. But when we think about like observability and kind of the space as a whole, what is it? You can kind of get this dictionary definition, a measure of how well internal states of a system can be inferred from knowledge of its external outputs. And that's great, but I think of it more as just like monitoring of applications and infrastructure, kind of getting that holistic view. And so when we think of some of the challenges and the problems that we're trying to answer are things like, do we know when our systems are down before our users tell us? So if we're a big bank or we're an e-commerce website and people aren't able to place orders on the website, that's obviously a big problem to our business. So we need to know when there's problems with any of our systems or any of our apps before our users tell us. Otherwise, we're going to have business impact and it's going to affect us and our revenue downstream. So we need to know when our users are down. And some other questions like, you know, how quickly can we solve some of these problems? If we're using a bunch of tooling that's either open source or closed source, of course today we're going to kind of focus on open source, but if we're using a bunch of technology that doesn't really work well together, it takes a long time to solve some of these problems. So we got to start asking ourselves, can we locate and solve some of these problems as fast as possible to reduce the impact onto the business? Can our systems notify us when something's wrong, right? With every monitoring alerting tool, we need to be notified when something goes wrong. And if we don't have the runbooks and the components in place to help us understand when these issues occur and why they occur, again, we're going to have these downstream impacts. And then finally, can everyone see what they need to see without wasting time between jumping between tools? So I'm sure for the folks in the room here and online, tool sprawl is a very real thing. A lot of different tools that can or do the exact same things. Are we able to use them effectively and efficiently together? So when we think about like the observability world, we might have three different logging tools, two metrics tools, and maybe a single APM tool. How can we work all these things together without really doing a lot of time jumping between tools? And I'm going to jump forward a little here today just because I know we've got a happy hour here to get to also. I don't want to spend the whole time. But as I talked about before, some of the things that are really key in the world of observability, apps and infrastructure, right? Are systems running properly? Are they working normally? Is there any downtime? Are there outages? Important to know. And then same with applications, right? Can our users log into our website? Are they able to access certain parts of our website or our apps, right? Just things that generally for a business are really important, right? Things need to be up. My wife tells me all the time, there's this one e-commerce shop that she likes to use. Every time she tries to check out, she can't friggin' do it. And she's like, why don't you call on them, help them out? And I'm like, not my account. But obviously these are really important and tie back to the world of observability. And if we kind of think back to infrastructure, something that has been really challenging to monitor over the years and is of course newer to the infrastructure world is Kubernetes. I actually saw something today on LinkedIn and it was like, Kubernetes just celebrated their 8th anniversary, so now recruiters can start asking for people to have 8 years of experience with Kubernetes. So, it's been a challenge to monitor, it's been a challenge to deploy, but obviously it's changing the way people deploy applications and run their software. So being able to monitor those, things like the hyperscalers, GCP and AWS and Azure, of course, really important. On-premise systems, so if we think of some of these companies that have been around for 100, 200 years, they're dealing with a lot of self-managed systems, monoliths, and those things need to be monitored as well. And then security. That's something that I think is really interesting in the world of observability is kind of the convergence of development and security, DevSecOps. So being able to look at something like a failed login on a website to understand if that's something that's actually wrong with the system or if that's something that's maybe a malicious actor is really kind of an interesting convergence. So that still kind of falls into the scope of observability. This talk is sponsored by Stella also. app observability kind of in similar manner, microservices, Kubernetes, right? Gotta keep monitoring those. But one that I'll point out here is shift left. And this is something that Grafana's company I think is a little unique in. We acquired a company about a year ago called K6 for load testing. And a lot of people were like, okay, that's kind of a strange marriage. Why do you want a load testing tool for an observability platform? But what we're seeing is a lot of people have this mentality of shifting left. So doing some of this load testing and observability earlier on in the production lifecycle so that you can identify when you do run these load tests where there's issues anywhere in your stack. Because the earlier you do that and the earlier that you find those issues, you don't deal with them in production as much. You don't get the step ones and everybody can sign off at 5 p.m. So the three pillars of observability, what are they? Metrics, logs, and traces. So metrics are telling us that something is happening. Maybe our CPU or our memory has gone up to 100%. So something has happened. And our logs are telling us, hopefully, what's happening if we've developed our code properly, telling us that there's an error or X, Y, or Z. And then where is it happening in the actual traces? There's a slow database call here, whatever it might be. So those are kind of the three pillars. And independently, you'll find that out in the market, there's tooling for each one of these, kind of isolated. And truthfully, even on a recorded line here, hopefully nobody says anything mean to me at work, but no company really does all these three things really, really well, even though that they all play together. So it's important to have either the best tool for each one of these or having tools that work together well and maybe sacrificing the best in class. So when we think about metrics, some common, both open source and closed source solutions, Prometheus, definitely the biggest one. Elasticsearch has a metric solution. Datadog has a metric solution. Victoria Metrics, like there's a lot of companies that handle the metrics problem fairly well. But again, definitely Prometheus probably being the biggest. Logging, Grafana's got a tool called Loki for logging. Elasticsearch is out there, Splunk is out there, again, Datadog. And then traces, you think of the AppDynamics, the New Relics, the Elastics, and then Tempo at Grafana Labs. So there's a lot of tooling out there, some open source, some closed source. Each kind of do things a little bit differently, but of course, trying to accomplish the same goals. And then within that kind of suite of technologies, right, they've all got their alerting and notifications, things like that. But as we think about the actual implementation of observability tools, you really kind of want to think about the operational aspect of it. You can have the best tools in the world. You can be paying 7-8 figures for these technologies. And if you don't have the playbooks and the components in place to actually have them run well, obviously you're not going to get value out of them. So defining things like, as you can see, SLAs, SLOs, and SLIs is really important in the world of observability. So defining in your contracts for users, maybe what percentage of uptime we want to see, right? Amazon's got the 99.9999, right? And they have to meet those SLAs. And if you have those SLAs in place, obviously you have to have technology in place that can track those. And of course, that's where observability comes into play. Same with SLIs, you know, metrics, we strive to be at X percentage of uptime. And SLOs, you know, this is actually our target, which is probably higher than that SLI. And then as we talked about before too, like you think about, like Google put out the SRE handbook, like these runbooks, right? When we do have a SEV1, when we do have an outage, what procedures and processes come into play to make sure that we're mitigating this risk as quickly as possible? Because again, if you have all these tools put in place and you don't have a procedure to solve your problems, you know, the world lights on fire and you're like, we don't know what to do. Everybody puts their hands up and says, it's not my problem. You have to have some of those pieces in place. And so of course the stock open source observability, can you do it all with open source software? Definitely. And that's where Grafana really comes into play. So, you know, people on the line here, as well as people in the room, it sounds like there's some experience with Grafana. So we are most widely known for our kind of front end visualization tool called Grafana. It's great at hooking in different types of data sources and visualizing them together in really kind of impactful, powerful views like this. But that's not all we do. We definitely kind of play into each one of these three pillars of observability as well, whether you're using our backend tools or you're using other tools out in the market. But again, we think about metrics. Metrics are numeric representation of data measured over intervals of time. You know, how much of our storage is filled, what's our CPU, what's our memory, what's our latency, saturation, things like that are all really important metrics. And as I talked about before, one of the most popular tools for that is Prometheus. And Prometheus is not a Grafana Labs project, but we are one of the largest contributors, probably the largest contributors out there for this technology. I think we employ just about half of the maintainers of Prometheus. But this is a metrics-based time series database. It works on a pull model rather than a push model. And it's very, very powerful. It's got a query language. It's great for high volumes of metrics. And Grafana has kind of become the default UI for Prometheus. So if you go into the Prometheus docs, you'll see Grafana kind of all over the place saying, you know, you can use the Prometheus UI, but we recommend using Grafana because it's a lot more powerful. A little more about Prometheus. I talked about and joked about the how it hit its eighth birthday today. And a lot of these traditional monitoring tools, traditional metrics tools, were not built with things like microservices in mind, Kubernetes in mind. But Prometheus definitely handles that really well. So we see a lot of customers working with some of these older legacy monitoring tools, and they just don't handle Kubernetes and microservices all that well. You can also run it on Linux and Windows, super easy to deploy, and it's great for enterprise scale. You know, the note here is we've seen 15 million active time series on a single Prometheus instance. So very easy to scale and great to run. If we move on and kind of think about logs, again, kind of that record of an event with a timestamp. So thinking about when we're getting our error logs or our out of memories, you know, things are successful, things are unsuccessful. In this one we see using token from a cache, an alert rule results in an error, you know, all really important things that we need to be monitoring. And sorry, this wire is all over the place. And logs are not all that valuable without metrics, and metrics are not always all that valuable without logs. So having them working together, saying that CPUs hit 100%, or sorry, memories hit 100%, and then our log saying there's an out of memory because the server restarted, are things that, again, kind of work side by side to help us with our troubleshooting. So really, really powerful. And the cool thing about logs is logs can also become metrics. Right, when you see a log line and it says there's been an error here, right? We want to be able to take that count of errors over time and turn it into a metric. As I kind of go back to that failed sign-in example as well, like that's a log that was turned into a metric. If we've seen 100 failed logins for Matt Stewart on this website over the last 10 minutes, that's a metric that was once a log. which is pretty cool, powerful, and again, kind of working together. Grafana has a backend tool for that called Loki. It's like Prometheus, but for logs, so it utilizes the same architecture and really very similar concepts, both from the query language as well as how things are stored to kind of operationalize this. So instead of with some traditional tools with logging, you're indexing an entire log line. That can get expensive. It can inflate the index. Grafana Loki is really only going to be indexing your timestamp and your Prometheus style labels. So the rest of that log line is not indexed, so it really saves space for the storage of that log while it's still all being very queryable, right? You can query it in a very similar way as Prometheus. This is awesome tech. This is one of the big reasons why I joined Grafana. I thought it was really unique, their approach to it. So certainly recommend taking a look at it. And then tracing. I won't lie, like this is probably the segment that I'm the least familiar with because I've never been a developer, so I can't, you know, really speak to it too heavily. But understanding, you know, from that first click on the website, all the systems and services and how they work and respond, how long they take, are there any errors within that trace, all throughout the application is really important. That'll allow you to see maybe right where in a code something executed slowly. So really, really powerful and pretty complex. There's a lot of companies that do this really well. But Grafana provides tools for all three of these, right? Metrics, logs, traces. And working them all together is, again, super powerful. I'll skip that. Tempo is our tooling for traces, again, built on a very Prometheus-like architecture. So if you're familiar with Prometheus, Tempo is hopefully not too much of a lift. And when you put them all together, you get that complete kind of observability solution. So instead of using Elasticsearch for logs, Prometheus for metrics, and Datadog for your traces, you have one tool that does all of them, speaks the same language, correlates well together, and really kind of reduces things like that MTTR that we're really trying to strive for. And then, of course, what good are these back-end tools without an awesome front-end? That's where Grafana comes into play, right? Whether you're doing bar charts or pie charts or gauges, you can kind of get crazy with the visualizations, which is exactly what Grafana is great at, right? So let's kind of see this all in action real quick. Like how do all these things work together and why is Grafana becoming a bit of a standard in the industry? It looks like this looks okay. Kind of step back. So this is a Grafana dashboard. It's doing monitoring of one of our front-end applications as well as the infrastructure. So both the application and the infrastructure side by side. And so we put ourselves in the shoes of somebody who's an SRE. And as we saw before, one of the things that's really important is alerting, getting alerts at the right time, and then also getting alerts for things that are meaningful. So in the Slack message, we can see that there's a high error rate identified on Web App 3. That's really valuable information. Again, that's kind of combining the log and the metric. We've got a lot of error rates on a specific application. Let's take a look. So we want to be able to click this link and have it pull us directly into the dashboard that responds to it, right? So we see a few things here. This first dashboard is looking at concurrent web app users over time for our three applications. We see how many alerts we're receiving and if they've been handled, the amount of concurrent users. You probably can't see this too well, but things like error rates, as well as all of our logs. And anytime we want to filter deeper into one of these, we can do our drag and drop, and everything else in the dashboard is going to update, right? So whether it's a log, whether it's a metric, whether it's a trace, everything here is updating together. And the cool thing about this dashboard here is it's not just using the Grafana backends. One of the things that's really important to us is letting you kind of choose the backends that you want to use. So if you're using Splunk or you're using Elastic, you're using Datadog, you can keep that data there and Grafana can hook into them and visualize them together, which is really, really great. I talked about choosing the best tool for your team, ones that people are enabled on and they know works well. You can still do that here using Grafana technology, which is really great. But what we're seeing on this dashboard, as we kind of relate it back to that Slack error, is high error rate identified on a specific web app. And so in this case, Web App 3 is this blue line. And if I back out a little bit again, we kind of see the sawtooth pattern, right, of our users climbing, 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 and then it drops off, climbing, 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 and it drops off. So certainly something is happening. We don't want zero users on our app really at any point. And if we look at these over time with some of these other views here, we see that with all these spikes and drops, we're seeing a large count in error codes. And that's what our Slack message was telling us. So we're able to pretty quickly deduce that, you know, one, something is wrong. And now we need to kind of figure out exactly what that is. We could scroll through all these logs here if we wanted to. They are fortunately color-coded, which gives us a little bit of an idea of things like errors. But maybe we want to go a little bit deeper. So we can expand this view here. We'll hit Explore. And what we're seeing now is the actual query that's put in place to return this this dashboard. We can see that Prometheus is our data source. If we wanted to swap this to any of our other data sources, we can do so. But we'll stick with Prometheus. And we can see that on our requests on this service, and let's just flip it to just that one web app that was concerning. In our Kubernetes production namespace, we're seeing, again, just those metrics, right? What we were seeing before. But where this kind of power of having tools that can work together and correlate together comes in is when we hit the split button. And now we're getting a side-by-side view. Doesn't really do much for us. But if we flip to our logging data source, so Loki in this case, one of the really nice things that it does, given that it works on a similar architecture as Prometheus, it was able to grab this service label here and automatically populate it here inside of our query bar from a logging perspective. So we don't have to go in and rewrite a query. It kind of took it for us and let us know. Now we're looking at just the logs from the service. And if we scroll down, we can see that long list of them, right? And that doesn't really do us a lot of good. It's important to have good query languages, but with just one tap on a keyboard, a comma, we can add another label. And we can say, show me also the logs where error level equals error. We can run that query, and now it's dropped from hundreds of logs down to a handful. And let's even kind of drill into a specific time zone. And if I kind of sync our view here, let's redo that. If I drill into this, you'll see that all of our logs are going to update too. So everything's very much synced. And if we scroll down into the logs themselves, you can see pretty quickly that we've got an out-of-memory error, right? That sawtooth pattern, probably not too unsurprising, and a server restarting, which tells us exactly the problem, right? We know what we need to go do. So again, kind of the power of tools working together and correlating together in a matter of a few moments, we're able to go from that alert in Slack to the dashboard that's telling us hopefully what's going wrong, pivoting and kind of seeing these two tools side by side. Because traditionally, you're probably jumping between browsers, you're trying to sync timestamps, making sure that they're all outputting at the proper time. It can get challenging and get complex. And with some of this open source tooling here, again, none of this here is something that would cost any money or requires a subscription. You're able to do things like reduce your MTTTR, which is really exciting in my eyes. And I think that is just about it. I probably should ask to pause for questions at some point during the presentation too, but any questions? Anybody using tooling like this? Any thoughts? I know we don't have for those online, we don't have a huge crowd out here, but curious if there's any questions. Cool.
I've got, so Grafana, you know, the front end piece, that's part of what you work on. What underlies that? Like as far as like the charting, the graphing, drawing that information, doing so, the animations.
So like what's the technology that supports it? So Grafana is actually a fork of Kibana, which is the visualization tool for the Elastic Stack.
What?
Of Kibana.
Okay.
This happened 7 years or so ago. Okay. But Grafana itself is like the actual visualization layer. So we're the company, Grafana Labs. The actual tech for like the UI component is just, it's just Grafana. So there's not really any other like tech that supports it or like other, it's kind of just like its own product.
Okay, so you have like your own JavaScript API that does all of the charting, and like that is your product.
Right.
Like you make libraries, you know, in different frameworks for people to consume your
right.
underlying components.
Yep. And so like all these views here are totally flexible too. So if I wanted to create a new dashboard, add a panel, it's as simple as just like choosing your data source. So again, here in Prometheus, you have all these different options for different ways to visualize this, and you build that specific view with maybe a specific query and you can view them all side by side, as we saw in that previous dashboard.
And these dashboards are all supposed to be composed through this dashboard editor. Like, you don't take these graph components and compose your own views of your own logs.
You can, yeah.
Oh, you can.
Yeah, so we provide a lot of out-of-the-box views, like if...
Yeah.
But like building your own dashboards is totally on you too, if you want to create them. Like, you can get as crazy or wild as you want. Like, we were looking at one earlier on Snowflake, which I thought was pretty interesting. Not really as much like an observability problem, but you know, if our Wi-Fi wants to cooperate here, not blaming Altmetrics Wi-Fi. Like these are things that can be all totally purpose-built, and it really doesn't matter what the data source is at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Because that's kind of the power of Grafana. We call it the big tent philosophy. Everybody's welcome under our big tent, regardless of the type of data. You can view them all side by side. And maybe like another kind of cool example of that here is if we use Splunk. Let's see if there's anything in here. Some of these just like don't have the data sources populating anymore. It's a big kind of shared environment that we use across our entire team.
That's super cool. You guys
have really cool dev. Yeah, absolutely. So like this has Dynatrace, ServiceNow, Splunk, and other, whatever other is. And these things are all side by side. And if there's anything time-based here, we scroll, it updates, it populates the rest of the dashboard from those data sources. So we're not hosting any of this data.
Yeah.
Because Splunk's not our tool. Dynatrace isn't our tool. We're just using their APIs to retrieve the results.
I have some more questions.
Yeah.
What about monitoring things other than
Your name again?
Louis.
So Louis asked, like, pretty much, is there a use case for this outside of like application and infrastructure monitoring?
Yeah.
If you think to like an IoT use case where you've got sensors on a machine line, or you're a company that's in the middle of Illinois that has a bunch of tractors and has 100 sensors on a tractor, like, can you return all these things? Yeah, absolutely. So there's a tool called exporters, which are purpose-built to, they're just exporters, to do that data collection. So really, regardless of the technology, you can pull that all in. So like, for example, if I jump into my personal one, I posted a blog on this the other day. I thought it was super cool, and so did the community. I felt like a micro celebrity for a couple days. But I got a Tesla last year, and I thought it would be cool to see if I could monitor like the health of it.
For your car?
Yeah, so yeah, you can see, again, I'm Chicago based. Cool. So like all this stuff's just available from the Tesla APIs. And again,
that's
given,
so cool.
Yeah, like we don't care what the data is.
This is really nice.
Can take it in. So
this is really, really, really nice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's really powerful, like what the UIs can do. So you can see, well, you can't see now. Let me flip to, my colleague has one too. Yeah, I mean.
Coded that up. What part of the stack are you using? Is that just like Grafana Pure and now a different data source? So like Grafana minus all the other things you just pitched us on.
So Grafana is effectively just the UI here that's fronting it. The back end technology for this is, if I hit Explore, I'm pretty sure it's Prometheus.
So
the metric solution.
Ingesting your Tesla data.
Right. Yep.
Okay.
So there's an API that goes to Prometheus. So all the data is being stored in Prometheus using that exporter. And then Grafana does the visualization.
I see. So the code you shipped was the exporter to make Tesla talk to Prometheus, and now Prometheus has specially labeled data that you can visualize in Grafana.
Exactly. Yep.
Okay.
So like if I were to, like, you can see like that's the query. Like, this is grabbing the metric inside temperature of the car.
That's a Prometheus query though. Like, you have to do work to put that information with that label in Prometheus.
Right, exactly. Okay. So, like, there's builders and stuff to make this a little bit easier. Like, all this is available, but this is converting it into from Celsius to Fahrenheit. I don't know why it outputs in Celsius.
I like it.
And then adds 30. So like that's like the equation to convert Celsius to Fahrenheit, and now it outputs it over time. So obviously with Chicago, like Detroit, that gets pretty variable over the course of a day, and it just gets output as a metric now inside of Grafana. And I had a colleague that built one too, and his was a little bit better than mine. I would never tell him that. But
so you could set an alert in Slack, the inside temperature gap.
Right. High. If it gets too high, if
yeah.
Like if my car all of a sudden becomes unlocked for whatever reason, because like with Teslas, it's all through a mobile app. So if somebody compromises my account, they unlock my car, I can see them driving away in relatively real time.
You're like building your own app.
Yeah.
So my colleague for this one, like he used Home Assistant. So if you use Home Assistant, run it on a Raspberry Pi. So, and I guess something else worth noting, like all of this was just running on a Raspberry Pi. So Grafana is super lightweight, Prometheus super lightweight. This actually uses Grafana Cloud. Not really relevant, but not necessarily for the sake of this talk. But you can add in things like variables. So if you know what your charging cost is, like what your electric company charges you to have electricity in your home, you can make a metric out of that. And I think down here, he has, you know, over the last 30 days, how much have I spent on charging? Because, yeah, if we look at like the actual query behind the scenes, it's just saying how much energy, how many kilowatt hours have been consumed, multiplied by, you know, that variable cost. So there's a lot that you can do. Like we have use cases of people monitoring like their beehive colony.
Yeah.
That's a pretty popular use case. We talk about like production lines. I mean, if you're a major automotive manufacturer, you've got these sensors all over the place. You need to be monitoring the health of them, the stability, like the temperature, things like that. And that all just gets output somewhere as a metric. Again, it doesn't matter what the back end is. It could be Influx, it could be Prometheus, it could be X, Y, or Z. It could be Google Sheets. And we can do all that collection.
I'm kind of curious, do you know any commercial applications of it in that way? Not obviously, you know, a million commercial applications for monitoring your application, right?
Mm-hmm.
But commercial applications for monitoring things that aren't an application.
Yeah, we can run to our website and see if we can find anything interesting. I've been with Grafana for about 3 months, so the success stories. No, it's a good question.
This is the not monitoring an application, just have to be the part that's most interesting to me
right.
personally.
Totally.
Okay, yeah, IoT. And then IoT gets into, you know, industrial monitoring, but I don't know if everything's quite there. A lot of that stuff's like on-prem, you know? So,
right.
Yeah, it's really interesting.
And, you know, it can be on-prem. Like, that's totally fine, too. Obviously, we have our cloud solution. But everything I talked about in the presentation, like this logging tool, the metric tool, the UI is all open source.
Right.
So even though we're a company, we got to keep the lights on. We got to keep our venture capitalists happy. Like, at the core, it's all open source technology.
Oh, yeah. This piece probably scales really well.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
It's a large and growing business.
For sure. All they do.
Can you speak to the model? So for a company that wants to implement the solution, what does that look like? What are they paying?
Yeah.
Set up fee? If it's open source, when does it become a paid product?
Sure. Thanks for asking. So Jacob asked pretty much, like, as maybe you evolve past, like, using this open source, why would a company maybe start paying Grafana? Is that?
I'm just asking in general, like, how would a company start using it more broadly?
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, one, you could just go to our downloads page. Like, all these tools are available if you flip to self-manage. So you can download these binaries, grab them from GitHub. You can run these things on your laptop. Like, Prometheus is super, super lightweight. Same with Grafana. They don't consume a lot of resources. Obviously, as you start to scale this out to terabytes of ingest a day, or millions of active series, or all kinds of traces, you eventually have to start running these on their own hardware, whether that's self-managed or in a hosted service, totally available. So we also work with like Amazon and Azure and GCP. We have our hosted service available through those hyperscalers to run. It's kind of up to you how you want to get running. I'm probably biased, but like running it on our hosted service is obviously going to be the easiest way, especially if you're a startup. You probably don't have the man or woman power to run an entire stack of, you know, probably a ton of different technologies, you know. And like the cloud's super secure. Like we have big banks. We have pretty much like everybody can run on the cloud. Like we've got a lot of the certifications and stuff that meet those highly regulated industries too. And there's also like a bit of like a, I think it's, yeah, play.grafana.org. So if you're curious, like the art of the possible, how else can we implement this into our company? This is just like a read-only view that's got a bunch of like these pre-built dashboards and stuff too. So this is looks like it's wind farm metrics, but you can go in and play around. Yeah, pretty cool. There's a lot of applications for it beyond traditional monitoring. Like we're seeing a lot of like BI use cases coming to us also. Yeah, because you know Excel is great, and you can hook Excel into like the data in Excel into Grafana, and build these really kind of cool, powerful visualizations too.
Yeah.
Actually, I don't know if Excel's in there, but Google Sheets is, so same thing, right?
You still have a question right out of my mouth. I was gonna ask about Google Sheets.
Yeah, yep, Google Sheets is in there. It's a little tricky to use, I found. Because one of the things that I was trying to do with that Tesla example was, I was struggling to convert the latitude longitude, and I was like, I'll just dump it all into, because they had to be a single field instead of like latitude and longitude, they had to be latitude comma longitude. I was like, I'll just dump it all into a Google sheet, merge the columns, but it was a little tricky to use, but it's definitely possible. Again, turning all of these things into a view. So it doesn't matter what the data is, it's good to go. Yeah, thanks. And if you are curious more, I'll do just a little pitch on an event. Next week, we have our global conference called GrafanaCon Online. We'll be talking about our latest release, 9.0, as well as some workshops, some other kind of fun talks from our CEO and our founders and our VCs. So it's free to attend, of course, if you're curious anymore at some of the application. Ryan, have we gotten anything in the chat, do you know? I don't think we have.
People from Poland saying hello.
All right, hello Poland. Patrick with a Y, I love that.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, thanks everybody for joining us here today. Thank you to our sponsors, Stella and Altimetric. again, my name's Matt Stewart. If you have any questions, you can probably find me through the meetup group now. But let's go to happy hour.